Go. Let's go ahead and get the news in, guys.
Yeah, you read the title right. EVGA is no longer going to be doing business with NVIDIA.
Bro, it's the end of the world. That's the end of the world. There's no way that's not the end of the world, man.
We gotta talk about this. Before we get into today's video, I want to go ahead and let you know about our new t-shirt design that's dropping, because it'd be really weird putting a sponsor.
I don't need a t-shirt when the world is ending, Jay. I need the news about the world ending, Jay.
It's around this video. No, there's no sponsors on this one. But it's our new dad bods and PC mods.
Today's sponsor is EVGA. Check out the affiliate link to buy nothing from EVGA down in the description below. EVGA, poor EVGA fanboy J2Cents.
Shirts, kind of pulling together two of my hobbies, cars and dad bods. Don't make me start reviewing dad bods. I'll do it, starting with mine. Okay, so I've got my computer up right here, if you're wondering. These are just basically notes that I've taken during a meeting that we recently had with EVGA. So to kind of give you a little bit of a background, EVGA has been in the GPU market and industry since 1999. Well, the company's been around since 1999. Just about as long as NVIDIA itself has been around. In fact, NVIDIA and EVGA partnered up very early on in the whole pre-Voodoo era and 3DFX era of graphics cards.
Yeah.
So to say that this is not like kind of big news for the industry is gonna be, it's interesting. I'm gonna do the best I can. I sort of, the bullet points and stuff I put down here sort of have a flow to it. I'm gonna try not to make this video too long, but I'm sure there's a lot of you that have a lot of questions. How does it affect you as a consumer? How does it affect you as an existing customer? And I'm gonna try and cover all of that
well,
today.
Well, I mean,
warranty
and all that.
A few of us that were invited to a very, I don't want to say secret meeting. It wasn't a secret. I mean, obviously there was an embargo regarding when we could make this announcement, and you'll see some other channels that have talked about it. We were invited to this meeting and we had no idea what it was about. I personally started speculating. It was very like no cameras, no recording, no nothing. It was very like, are we going to the White House? Like, I don't know what's happening, right? And so I had this speculation. I thought, well, maybe EVGA is gonna make an AMD graphics card, because we've seen EVGA now make AMD motherboards. So what are we gonna see? The title is what we were seeing, which was a complete blindside, no idea this was coming, announcement that EVGA will not be making 40 series graphics cards or any subsequent graphics cards after that, as EVGA is fully breaking its business partnership with NVIDIA. Now, as we move forward in this, it's important to note that this was a direct...
But why? Why, Jay? Why?
...meeting with the CEO of EVGA. His name's Andrew, by the way, and I'll probably refer to him as Andrew, mostly because I don't want to mutilate his last name. It was a fairly long meeting. We talked about a lot of things. And I feel like a lot of it turned into like almost trying to convince him not to do this. But again, so the bullet points and the notes and stuff that I have here, I'm gonna just kind of go through them, because I wanna make sure that the information is accurate and stuff. But it's also important to note that this is, as we're reporting this, there's gonna be a lot of allegedly, and there's gonna be a lot of like according to and stuff like that. Because,
well, you should dump all your tech stocks, Detroit. Not financial advice, but I mean, it's also too late for that. But you know, you should have dumped your tech stocks a little bit ago, but it is going to get worse, because like, who are they going to sell graphics cards to? Poor people? Poor people don't buy graphics cards. Poor people buy Xbox Series S. Like, poor people don't buy GPUs, bro.
Because
and everybody's about to be poor. So, like, bro, this is like 2008. Like, remember like 2008 when like you were like, I don't know, I was really broke in 2008, 2009 era. And like, I didn't make much money. And like, I was happy to have a bubble TV with an Xbox 360 to play Gears of War on. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're going back to those days, boys. Xbox Series S, maybe not a bubble TV, because luckily TVs got cheap, but ain't nobody buying a fucking $2,000 graphics card, and there's nothing to mine with them anymore. Dude, is this really like EVGA is actually going out of business? EVGA pass.
I'm not privy to firsthand knowledge. This is all second and third-hand knowledge as portrayed by EVGA. But basically, the relationship has been strained between NVIDIA and EVGA.
Mr. Strick and was rich.
Side note, this isn't anything that was mentioned there. This is not the first time I've heard this. This is not the first time I've had AIBs open up with certain meetings saying, man, I'll tell you what, it is rough. Oh yeah, it's a rough market. Yeah, of course, but it's rough being a partner of NVIDIA. The reason for that is NVIDIA is very, very strict with how they
had a 32-inch bubble TV from Philips.
By the programs, I mean being an AIB or an add-in board partner.
Pretty happy with it.
And
had a VHS player in it too.
Is in the business of manufacturing and selling the graphics cards that they design using NVIDIA's architecture design. But NVIDIA is very strong-armed in what the brands are allowed to do. Do you remember the old days when we would see like the crazy dual graphics boards where you'd see like the Mars card? I think it was like the 960 Mars or something like that from Asus, where we'd see like these crazy dual chip designs and stuff. NVIDIA never sanctioned any of that sort of stuff. In fact, NVIDIA is the one that's put a stop to all of that sort of custom stuff. Remember when graphics card manufacturers, outside of the actual manufacturer themselves, the AIBs were able to add RAM? Remember they were able to add versions of their own that had more RAM to, again, NVIDIA putting a stop to all of that. NVIDIA has very, very tight control over the parameters at which the board partners were able to operate within.
Can't BIOS flash, can't overvolt, unless you got a kingpin.
The enthusiast market, if you will. When enthusiasts running these companies and designing this stuff were able to kind of go, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we, and then they would do it. Well, NVIDIA doesn't allow that anymore. And so that's why you've seen a lot of these really custom, and when I say custom, I don't mean like kingpin. Yes, kingpin is a custom power delivery design and such, but in terms of the core design and you know, the RAM layout and all that's all very tied down and strict within the NVIDIA partner program. When you'd see these crazy custom boards that had dual GPU designs and stacked boards. Remember when they tried to come up, when I say they, I mean just custom designers would come up with a stacked PCB, where it's essentially two graphics cards that had an interconnect and then one PCIe slot, that crazy stuff
hey,
that you
Pox.
Try and think would have fun and
yeah, I'm catching up
move
right
the
now.
Market forward. And no, all of that was
yeah,
shut down.
Yeah, James, I know all
NVIDIA.
That.
And that's not EVGA saying that. That's just what I know from the decade I've been doing this and having a lot of off-the-record conversations with different people and just how difficult it's been to be an NVIDIA partner. EVGA also sharing that sentiment. Very difficult to be an NVIDIA partner. And what do I mean by that? When
nice,
you're in the
Pox.
Business of creating graphics
Thanks
cards
for letting me
on,
know.
On the back of another company, being NVIDIA in this case, the AIBs were often the last to know when they were being launched, the last to know what they were gonna cost, the last to know what basically anything Jensen was gonna get on stage and say. I cannot tell you how many times I've had conversations with market reps that told me they found out the same time we did. Now you would think a company like EVGA would be some of the first to know. I can tell you right now, more often than not, we as reviewers get the drivers before the AIBs do. They have functioning working cards because they have schematics they're working within. Functionally they work, but in terms of being able to like see their true potential and it's the software that requires to unlock that, the drivers and such, they don't even have access to them. I'm about to knock that over. They don't even have access to them. It's, I can't tell you how many times it's been like, hey, do you have a driver? It's like, well, I have a press driver. And it's like, okay, because we have nothing. And that's crazy. That's absolutely crazy to me to think that NVIDIA would put partners that in the dark. And I think it's about leak protection, leak control, honestly. I think that's what the reason is. And it, when they control the drivers and such by getting them to the press partners, like us and Linus and Gamers Nexus and Paul and Kyle and Harvard Canucks and all of them, they at least know at least, okay, moving forward from here, there's probably gonna be some leaks that are make their way out, but it's within a very controlled environment where it's very close to launch, whereas the AIBs are building boards probably months ahead of time.
Just shut down 95%
so
of your GPU
I'm
farm.
This over, I swear. It's about leak
well,
control, I have no doubt.
EVGA's going
but
out of business.
Imagine trying to run your business on that. Because the other thing that was an unknown is what's the allocation gonna be? Remember, NVIDIA has its partners.
Everybody's hurting, man. It's crazy.
And it has to divvy up the stuff, in this case, the cores, amongst its partners. Now you're gonna have your favorites. You're gonna have your high performers.
NVIDIA's bad as a partner? Oh, who would have thought?
And you're gonna have your underperformers. Maybe brands that don't sell as much. You never know exactly what you're gonna get. Especially over the last couple of years with how constrained things were. Imagine trying to run a business on not knowing what you're gonna have and when you're gonna have it and even what's it gonna cost. So you can imagine, if you don't know how much of it you're getting, how can you put together a business plan to keep your business running? Now, one of the things you have to understand too, it's a very competitive market. You've got a lot of brands out there making graphics cards, and they're all competing. And so one of the things that you have to do is you have to try and price position yourself so that you can still stay afloat and make ends meet in terms of operating costs of your company. But there's not a lot of margin in graphics cards. I don't think a lot of people realize that when it comes to the actual profit margins of graphics, it's very low. If you are an AIB, let's say EVGA, and you're selling on Amazon, and you're selling at Best Buy, and you're selling at Micro Center, and you're selling at what other, I guess, Newegg or whatever other retailers there are.
What's up,
there's
Necro?
A lot of time and money and cost and effort and advertising that goes into each one of those outlets. And each one of Fright those Club. Outlets get a piece of the cost too. So you see your margin just gets thinner and thinner and thinner. That's the cost of doing business. But what happens when the company at which you're partnered with starts undercutting you? What do you do then? Because that's exactly what NVIDIA is doing right now. And this is one of the principles that EVGA is basing its decision upon, is that NVIDIA is now competing with its own partners. Now, this is something that myself and other reviewers were concerned about back in 2016 when we were in Austin, Texas for the Pascal launch, when they first launched the very first Founders Edition card with the 10 series. We were very concerned, like, what does this mean for their partners? Does this mean NVIDIA is now doing business against the people they're selling the core to, which seemed like a very interesting conflict of interest. If I were a board partner, I'd be kind of concerned if the person I'm buying GPUs, and by GPUs, well, I mean the core.
Yeah, from, I mean, we knew that was coming.
Is now in business
but like why?
With me. That showed NVIDIA's why, true colors about even being honest came out and showed that NVIDIA was absolutely...
Jay, I need you to tell me, are they making AMD GPUs?
In business against the AIBs from that moment forward. Can always build the board cheaper than you because there is... This is an image taken from Best Buy. You can see that right now a 3090 Ti Founders Edition is for $1,099.
Yeah.
That is $900 below the MSRP of $1,999. Pretty good deal. I think most people would agree, given... if the $2,000 was ever actually worth it. This is the price of the Furthermore 3 card, which is currently showing unavailable. Now you know why, and we'll explain that supply chain in the next section of this video.
I know.
$1,399.
$1,399.
But this is a direct example of, again, what EVGA is explaining.
We've talked about this. We've like the whole time, like we've said on the channel, you know, don't buy any of the, you know, right now, don't buy any of the non-Founders Editions. Another thing that NVIDIA did was their Founders Editions didn't get light hash rate. They basically forced their board partners to have light hash rate and then left their cards fully unlocked. Right? So from the mining perspective, like we saw that too. Like if you bought a Founders Edition 3070, it was fully unlocked. If you bought a 3070 from EVGA, it was light hash rate locked. So like clearly like NVIDIA was fucking people over there too, right?
A disrespect, a non-mutual agreement, strong arm tactics, play ball by NVIDIA's rules or they're gonna screw you, and then they end up screwing you anyway with pricing like this. Because it is the cheapest 30 series, 3090 Ti on the market, period, in terms of compared to the AIBs. So NVIDIA, being in the precarious position of obviously having a lot of 30 series to offsell, will absolutely smack the face of all their partners just...
Excuse me, Mr. Strick. I am not a shill. Please check out the affiliate link down in the description below.
To get back some of that cost. So whereas EVGA's principles kind of stand is all of those things I've already explained. Not knowing when the product is coming, when it's gonna launch, how much is it gonna cost, when's it gonna be available, not even getting drivers before reviewers. It's kind of like a bad relationship that you finally just had enough of. We specifically asked EVGA, okay, what does this mean then? What's the future of EVGA? Because now it sounds like, one, maybe they should partner up with another brand, AMD, Intel, sell the company. What's the future? EVGA not selling graphics cards, they're just E at that point. There's no more VGA. EVGA always stood for Extreme Video Graphics Adapter, right? So that's what E was. It was always Extreme. Now just Extreme. We're extremely not going to be selling graphics cards anymore. So Andrew said he has zero interest in selling the company. He will not be selling the company at all. I mean, they apparently they own outright the building that they're in. Their overhead costs are very low. It's not like it's going to be a sinking ship or anything. This is a very calculated decision they've decided to make, where apparently, allegedly, the
motherboards
and strained relationship that exists between NVIDIA and EVGA is just not feasible anymore. And that's the takeaway from the meeting. Andrew's fear, if he were to sell the company, is what does the future leadership of the company do? Do they just then start making mediocre product? Do they just start making
power supplies?
Bad decisions that no longer go with the last 22 years of principle and philosophy within the company are? Because you have to admit, like, there's no brand I can mention where people don't have a problem with it. So that aside, EVGA has had one of the best warranty
programs. How are they gonna make money?
Step-up program, standing by their product, US-based repair centers.
How are y'all gonna make money, bro?
About EVGA's warranty and RMA process, you're gonna find outliers where people that have had
sure, hope I don't have stock in EVGA right now.
But overall, it's been positive.
Hold on, sell it.
And I feel
sell.
And that really sort of sucks. So what does this mean now if you're a current 30 series owner that's still under warranty, or let's just say you just literally today you bought a 30 series EVGA card. And you've got a 3-year warranty or whatever the warranty is on that card, and you're like, crap, what does that mean for my warranty? I asked that question specifically. There's a formula that they use because they have massive amounts of data of what are the yields, what are the failure rates, you know, what's the likelihood that you're going to have to warranty a product and how much of it are you gonna have to warranty. They will continue selling 30 series cards that they currently have in inventory until they're gone. And however long that lasts is gonna depend on, again, what's current pricing going to do? What's availability of 40 series going
to
look
all
like?
All have is saying they'll make more money now, but how will they make more money now? It's still a portion of your.
It could take some time, depending on what that.
It's still a portion of your cash flow that gets removed.
Like inventory that they have sitting there.
Look, just because they stop selling GPUs doesn't mean they all of a sudden start magically selling more power supplies and motherboards. Thanks for the follow, Big Rojas. Big
I can
Red.
Tell you that apparently. Right now, they don't have any 30 series coming in from NVIDIA right now, because NVIDIA is obviously aware of all of this. It's not like we're notifying NVIDIA of this breakup. They already know. That's why, you know, you're not going to see EVGA's name on any 40 series stuff. So it's important that you guys, if you're waiting for 40 series EVGA stuff, it's not coming. So anyway, 30 series, there you have a form.
But low margins doesn't mean, I mean, I guess maybe if we're moving into like, you know, here's where it could be. Here's what I'll give you, right? If we already know that Jensen was talking about manipulating price for the 40 series and the 30 series. So if they were manipulating that price to bring it down, and then it was honestly hurting EVGA from the perspective of not making any money on the 40 series, then I guess, yeah, you cut it off now because you'd be losing money on the 40 series, right?
Formula that they're going to be holding back product to have on hand specifically for warranty issues. So your RMA is still good. Your warranty is still good. Hopefully the formula is accurate enough to where, let's say, 2 years and 10 months from now, you have a 3090 that dies. They'll have a warranty replacement for you or something. I hope it doesn't turn into more. There are more RMAs than there are backlog/reserves. I really hope they're on the ball.
Well, I mean, I feel like they are going to be on the ball for that because, as we know, there's an overstock of 30 series already. And with the recent turn of events with the merge in crypto mining, I don't think that's going anywhere anytime soon.
On that one, because that can turn into a really ugly situation. But the future of EVGA looks like they're going to really focus on their other arms. Remember, EVGA is not just graphics. They've got power supplies. EVGA is very passionate about its power supplies. It really wants, the EVGA as a brand.
We're very passionate about our power supplies, my friends. Very passionate. We have the best power supplies. They're the best power supplies available. We're very passionate about our power supplies. Very proud of our power supply team.
Really wants to focus on power delivery. And hey, that might be a better industry if...
Look, you know what though? I'll tell you this. The problem is EVGA doesn't even have ATX 3.0 and PCIe 5.0 power supplies ready yet. So if they're very passionate about their power supplies, I don't buy it. MSI already has announced PCIe 5.0 and ATX 3.0 support. if you're passionate about power supplies, you should be announcing that now, especially with this announcement.
40 series demands what we're seeing it might demand in terms of power delivery. That might be a smart move. There's gonna be a lot of people need to upgrade their power supplies with 40 series. We already know that. They've got their peripherals, like keyboards and mice, and the very small
Evil
portion
ACC
of the peripherals,
is
like
saying that Uber's been hacked.
Maybe they had sound cards for a little while there.
That's gonna F over all the Uber drivers, right?
Huge market for them, but they do have still are gonna have Intel motherboards.
I don't have any money,
AMD
so it doesn't matter.
You've already mentioned Dark Kingpin. All that sort of stuff. But to kind of recap
this.
Nor
do we
this,
use any cards on Uber.
I feel like the industry is unfortunately losing a very important
fact that the admin level
in the market when it comes to.
Ooh, so that's bad for all the drivers
EVGA
and stuff.
How really stood by its product. Right? I mean, I've been a customer of EVGA since like 2003, nearly 20 years. So to me, it's
20
like,
by Tony.
I know
killing
I left
you.
That meeting, which ended up
I hope you're laughing
four
real
hours
hard and having a good day.
Going, man, why do I feel like I just went through like a divorce mediation. It was really weird. I've never been through divorce mediation.
I'm
by
sure
the way.
It would include Uber anything, Eats.
So I've only been married one time, but never. But anyway, I just imagine that's what it would feel like. Just emotionally, like just drained of going, okay, now we got to comprehend and process and I almost said decompose this info, whatever. Poop it out into this video for you guys to kind of understand.
Thanks. But we got the idea, Jay. I'm done with you. Get out of here, Jay. Everything's dying, guys. That was a Kingpin 10 series Necro. Like a 1080T Kingpin. On his desk. Everybody's dead. Like, we're all gonna be poor. It's fucked. Like,